Hello everyone, I'm John Bodie for Kestrel Community News, and I'm here with Ann Kearns, who's the volunteer coordinator who sets up all these wonderful walk and talks. Thank you for doing this.
My pleasure.
And also I'm here with Josh Rose, who's going to lead a butterfly walk today up at Scarborough Brook. It's a wonderful place. And why did you choose Scarborough Brook?
Well, Scarborough Brook is sort of a signature habitat area for Kestrel. It kind of has one of everything, but this time of year, August, we're likely to find a plethora of butterflies and maybe dragonflies, damselflies, who knows, because we've got this beautiful open meadow out here, and that's the kind of habitat that they enjoy, they thrive in. Scarborough Brook is a combined effort of Kestrel Land Trust and the Belchertown Conservation Commission and the Commonwealth in Massachusetts, and it's been a wonderful enterprise. The New England Scenic Trail runs through it, so you can begin in this beautiful flat area, and then if you want to walk on up into the beautiful forest, you have that option too.
Great. Thank you, Anne.
Pleasure.
So we're going to go see butterflies. Josh, are butterflies like people? Do they want to eat specific nectar from specific plants?
Well, the adult butterflies actually know. When the adult butterflies, you know, kind of any nectar is good nectar for them. They will be picky about plants in that some plants make a lot of nectar and others don't make so much. Mm-hmm. And some plants are shaped a particular way so that it's easy for some insects and hard for other insects to get to the nectar.
Yeah.
And so things like Monarda, bee balm, has a kind of a long tube-shaped flower, which kind of ironically bees have trouble getting down the long tube and often have to cut a hole in the flower from the side.
Yeah, yeah.
But butterflies with a long tongue can get down the tube and suck the nectar out. So there's some pickiness about nectar and flowers, but not as much. Caterpillars, on the other hand, butterfly larvae, are extremely picky.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of butterfly species and also moth species that can only be found in the vicinity of one particular plant species.
Wow.
And if the plant species is gone, the butterfly is gone.
Wow.
So one example.
So that's like a monarch.
Right. Monarch only eat milkweeds.
Yeah.
There's one other kind of in this area. A lot of people go looking for the frosted elfin, specializes on a particular species of wild lupin around here.
Yeah, yeah.
And so you can only find it at places where the lupins are growing.
Wow, that's cool.
Now the other Anne mentioned dragonflies and damselflies. Something else we'll look for today. They are much less picky about what they eat. They're predators. They're carnivores.
Ooh.
And eat basically anything that moves. But many of them are very
humans.
If we were small enough, they would. I've heard some people say that, you know, if you've seen about the old fossil dragonflies that had like 3-foot wingspans, and their larvae actually, current day dragonfly and damselfly larvae are aquatic and live underwater.
Uh-huh.
Back then, when the 3-foot dragonflies were around, their larvae crawled around on land.
Oh, and baby!
I've heard some people suggest that if those were still around, people would still be living in caves.
Okay.
But anyway, they're not at all picky about what they eat, but they're very picky, dragonflies are, about where they eat, about their habitat.
Okay.
And certain will only live in like running water, like little streams and creeks.
Yeah.
Some will live only in peat bogs. You only find them in areas with sphagnum moss.
Yeah. Wow, cool. So we're going to see butterflies and damselflies and dragonflies.
I hope so.
Cool.
And maybe a few other bugs too.
So. Oh, wonderful. Well, let's get out on the trail and take a look at what we can see.
Sure.
Thanks, John.
Thank you.
To the turf. Oh, there's two of the wood nymphs. Oh yeah, they're a type of scarab too. They're another member. The scarab beetles are a family. Scarabaeidae.
This one, he's got kind of a black body, and then tail,
cool.
Black abdomen, and then his forward part of his body is green.
You do that without your glasses?
And if you look very closely at him, or if you have binoculars like me, you can see he actually has what looks like two exclamation points on his back. And those two exclamation points are the recognizing mark of the fragile fork tail. So. If anybody really wants,
my
name is Fragile Forktail.
Or if you like scientific names, Ishnura posita.
Ishnura? If anybody wants to borrow Binox.
This guy, they frequently, you'll see them hovering along plants, plucking prey off. They eat really tiny little things like aphids and white flies and things like that. So pretty much everything. Dragonflies, if you're an insect eater, dragonflies and damselflies taste great. None of them are toxic or anything. Birds, spiders, frogs, lizards, you know, other dragonflies and damselflies, robber flies, all sorts of predators will go after dragons.
That's an eastern forktail?
Yes.
You know what I mean? They're better.
Very good. Got a green body, blue tail, blue dot in the tail, and black in between.
You can try. Do you want to try a different
one? Pickerel frog.
Yeah,
pickerel frog and a pearl crescent.
Wow.
So stop walking. The frog.
Right here.
The frog is right there, right just a couple inches from my net handle. You see the frog hiding in the grass there?
Beautiful.
And then just to the right, about half a foot to the right of the frog, you can see the orange and black butterfly flexing his wings. That's the pearl crescent. We came in to see the pearl crescent, and the frog jumped out of its hiding place. Wow.
So that's a pearl crescent, that butterfly.
That butterfly is a pearl crescent.
We saw and yesterday.
Can everybody see the leopard frog, pickerel frog? Okay, do you see that three-leaved kind of brownish plant there? Territory over good breeding habitat. And any female that comes in and wants to lay eggs there has to mate with the male to get access to the territory to lay eggs.
Does anybody know what this bush is?
And then, so what you saw when you saw the dragonflies fighting with each other is males sparring with each other over who gets to control the territory and who gets to mate with the females who come in.
Interesting.
And so, like, kind of the biggest, fastest, toughest males get the best territory, or the most territory, and guard it, and they get to mate with the most females. The dragonfly we're talking about is it's one of a group called the emeralds. And if you see those eyes, if you see its eyes in the right light, the eyes just light up and are blindingly green when the light hits them the right way.
Oh, yeah.
And females are usually yellowish, and then you get kind of orange ones. This one's kind of orangey. It's sort of transitioning from yellow to red. But it's mostly red. It's mostly mature, and it's a male.
And this is what is it?
This is a meadowhawk.
What's their lifespan?
As an adult, like a month or two.
Oh, that long?
Yeah, I think so. So some of them, there's one, the autumn meadowhawk can actually fly even into November or December if the weather's warm enough. This guy's not an autumn meadowhawk. Autumn meadowhawks have pale legs. This guy's black legs. He's got a very pale face, which means he's probably either either a white-faced meadowhawk, or there's like two or three species that are really similar to each other. The white-faced and cherry-faced meadowhawks and the ruby meadowhawk. He's probably a ruby or maybe a white-faced. But he's probably a ruby meadowhawk. And so this red tail with the black triangles going down it, or if it's a female, it would be yellow with black triangles going down the tail. The meadowhawks are very much late summer and fall dragonflies. If you get into October, November, meadowhawks will be the only dragonfly you see sometimes. Meadowhawks are just starting to come out and breed now, a few species of them. We dragonfly nuts call an exuvia. The exuvia is the skin of the dragonfly larva, which when they're ready to become an adult, they shed it as they grow larger, and then when they're ready to become adults and have wings and fly, they crawl out of the water to shed their skin one last time and fly away.
Cool.
And that last kind of shed skin, the largest one from the largest larval stage, is often a useful tool for people studying dragonflies to figure out what species are living in the pond that you're at. Because you can't always see the adult dragonflies if they're there or not. But they leave the exuvia behind as a clue they were around. So. The dragonfly larvae live underwater and eat kind of all sorts of underwater prey. Worms, tadpoles, even small fish, other insects, anything that moves really. And then when they're done with that, they crawl up and shed this skin. One of the newts swimming up? There's red-spotted newts out there. So, and
that probably goes back and forth, where when the dragonfly larvae are small, the newts are a predator that can eat them. And then when the dragonfly larvae get big enough, they could actually eat some of the smaller newts, or at least newt larvae.
Wow.
So, anyway, so this is what the dragonfly larva looks like during the underwater larval stage.
Amazing.
And you can see this sort of thing, this straight thing under its head. That's called its labium, and it's actually a hinged arm that can spring out and catch prey. So the larva goes around with this thing under its head like this, and when it sees food, that little thing under its head springs out and grabs the food and then pulls it into the dragonfly larva's mouth to eat it.
Wow.
So,
wow.
So they're really amazing formidable predators.
Good job spotting that.
What kind is it? A slaty?
A slaty skimmer.
From the slaty blue-gray color.
But the larvae of the skimmer family are kind of more shorter and fatter and more compactly shaped than the larvae of the darner family. So that exuvia is definitely from a darner and not a skimmer.
Why are they called skimmers?
There are some dragonflies over there.
Because when they're flying around, they kind of skim over the water surface.
Okay. So, I've got to make sure he doesn't fly away. I get my hand in there. So this is what's one of the dragonflies. We saw the common green darners before. And the green darners are one group of darners, the genus Anax. There's also a genus Aishna, the mosaic darners. And this is one of the mosaic darners I have here in the net.
Wow.
Oh my God.
Oh, wow.
What is it again? Mosaic?
I'll have to take a close look to be sure what species it is. But at first glance, I think it's a black-tipped darner. But there's several similar ones, black-tipped and shadow darner and Canada darner, are all mosaic darners with this similar pattern of brown body with blue, with green and blue pat spots and stripes on it.
And they're the ones that don't land very frequently?
Yeah, the darners don't land much. So, to get a really good look at a darner and to be able to identify a mosaic darner, you generally have to catch it. They only land when it's getting dark or when it's raining, usually. They will land when it gets too hot, but that's mainly in the tropics. It doesn't ever get too hot around here for the darners to land. You go down here, this last segment has no black, has no blue spots. It's totally dark. And most of the other mosaic darners will have a pair of blue dots on every segment. This one that has one segment with no spots is black-tipped.
It's interesting. So looking at its head, I can focus clearly, but the top of its head with that white dot, are those the eyes, compound eyes? Or?
Yeah.
And it look, it's
that white dot's kind of that white dot's kind of an illusion created by the light shining on it and getting refracted by the individual eyes. But
look at the so
it's
wings.
It's not even real, the white dot.
Right. It's called sometimes you'll see a black one. It's called a pseudo-pupil.
Wow.
And that pseudo-pupil is kind of an illusion created by the thousands and thousands of little individual parts of the compound eye.
Look at the blue in the black dots. So beautiful.